Good evening and welcome to this public worship service held at St John's Presbyterian Church, Annerley, with our own pastor, Reverend Martin Duffield, leading worship on this occasion. To you. But you are now encouraged to engage in personal preparation just prior to the call to worship. Thank you.
Psalm 29 verses 1 and 2 says, "Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name, and worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." Let's continue to worship him with a prayer this evening. We'll meet with him to adore him in our prayers now. Let's pray. Almighty God, our God, great in glory and power and majesty, your greatness and your power we confess are beyond telling. Those of your servants who understand these, the great things of science, have an even better insight into your attributes than do we. For they see more and they see farther, and they see more clearly the wonder of your mind and your thoughts, the greatness of your energy and your power in all the creation. But even they, for all their brilliance, their knowledge and understanding, run out of numbers as they run out of adjectives to be able to describe your works as they see them through the telescope or the microscope. How great are the works of your hands, which reveal your eternal power and your invisible attributes, and how glorious and how wondrous are the things that you have done and still do and can do beyond our telling. And so, our God, we pray, we humble ourselves in the presence of your majesty and in the quiet of this holy hour, because it's our very great privilege, we who are so small and so weak, so frail and so mortal, so sinful and so corrupt. It is such a great privilege to be able to meet with you, who is so great and glorious and so holy and good, to bring the humble sacrifices of new covenant worship. How blessed are we to be here with you, to know that in the Spirit, to know that the Spirit, our Lord Jesus Christ, who is risen, is actually among us in this hour. So help us to give our full attention to your words, to us this evening in the readings and in their exposition tonight. Give us grace to be able to sing it joyously as you praise, to your praise and for all. And all for your pleasure, and your pleasure alone. Our greatest joy is your pleasure. And this is never more true than when we have come to worship, as we have set aside time to do tonight, to do as you've commanded and as you deserve. So accept us in the name of your beloved Son and our beloved Saviour Jesus Christ, and help us to worship in the grace and the strength of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to sing to God's praise from the 99th Psalm. It's "The Lord God Reigns in Majesty."
Thank you.
Let's hear the word of God for the first time tonight from 2 Kings as we consider the miracles, the miracle tonight with respect to our Lord and water.
So this first reading is from second book of Kings, chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 1 through to verse 7. 2 Kings, chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. And the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, "See now, the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to the Jordan, and let every man take a beam from there, and let us make there a place where we may dwell." So he answered, "Go." Then one said, "Please consent to go with your servants." And he answered, "I will go." So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and said, "Alas, master, for it was borrowed." So the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick and threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore he said, "Pick it up for yourself." So he reached out his hand and took it. Amen.
Let's again pray as we confess our sins to him tonight. Let's all pray. Our Holy Father, perfect in righteousness and only good, as sinners we bow low and confess our sin to you tonight. We acknowledge we break your laws, your holy laws, and all 10 of them. And as the Apostle said, when we offend in one, we offend in all. We are particularly prone to the great sin of faithlessness. We sometimes do not trust, and sometimes we cannot trust. We know at such times we are very, very weak. We are very prone to fear and to forgetfulness of your power and your promise and your presence. We can become completely spiritually disorientated. And as a result, we look everywhere but up. Blessed are you, our Lord, for you understand our Father. You know our frailty better than we do. And so forgive us, our God, for denying your super adequacy for us in every situation, at all times. We know the words, we comprehend the truth, but it is in the practice that we are found wanting, and often when troubles and threats come. But may we be prepared day by day in this knowledge and in your holy presence. May we ever take time to ground our day in your greatness and strength. Fill us with your spirit, and so fill us full of trust. But without that, we are prone to the failures of fear, and fear itself sometimes is a failure. Build us up in the most holy faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, and may his Spirit enable us to be your servants at all times, and especially in times of trouble. We ask this with the forgiveness of all our other sins in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing again. And worship to God with the hymn, "Hail to the Lord's Anointed." going to hear from the Word of God again in chapter 14 of Matthew as we look at the first part of the miracle of the walking on the water of our Saviour. Matthew chapter 14.
Matthew chapter 14, and we'll begin at verse 22 and read through to verse 33. So this is immediately following the feeding of the 5,000. Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening came, he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." So he said, "Come." And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Amen.
Amen. Let's just take a moment now as we meditate upon God's goodness in the week, and then we shall come to our prayer of thanksgiving. Recent ones and ones in the distant past. Thank you for your patience with us as children as we've learned to trust and obey you through these times. Thank you for the trust that is manifests itself also in giving cheerfully and generously, even beyond our covenant tithe, as we are able to do. Take our gifts this evening and preserve and promote the gospel here and everywhere our compassion goes. Feed the hungry, we pray. Heal the wounded. Enlighten the ignorant and open the eyes of the spiritually blind. Make great use of the good things we have given through the week and given tonight. And we ask this in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing again to God's praise, standing on the promises. moment to pray for others. We have the Indian Reform Fellowship before us tonight. We have the state government and also a word of prayer for our sister Jasmine Pierce, who's in training for her schoolies mission in a week's or so's time. So let's pray. Our Father in heaven, as we come to pray for others, as you call us and is our duty and responsibility and is a measure of our love for our fellow Christians in service around the world, we remember the Indian Reform Fellowship and we continue to pray for our brother Richard Wilson as he battles with an incurable illness. The best which he can do is to slow its progress until you take him to yourself. But we thank you for the opportunity that he has, through the wonders of technology, to actually spend more time face to face with his brothers and sisters in India. Now, because of the technology, than he was ever able to do when he was able to fly over. Please give him wisdom with his health and his strength. Thank you for Samuel Christian and his wife Druti, who've just gone back to India to begin a work in their home village. Would you pray for him that everything he needs may be met, that the container with all of the furniture and other things may arrive safely, and that you would help him to establish the work quickly. Begin to bring to bear the love and the grace and the truth of the gospel on his hometown. We pray for Uma Sharma up in Nepal and up in the Himalayas. Kathmandu, Lord, I thank you for his work. Thank you for the six families, I think all non-Christian, whom he fed whilst they were in lockdown, had no other source of food, young children. Thank you for the testimony of love of your people from here who supported him with cash donations and help, and for the fact that he's still doing that kind of work. Lord, please may it result not only in the feeding of hungry bodies but the feeding of hungry souls as well. Thank you for Pastor Moses in Ramachandrapuram and also Hiral Solanki in Delhi for the work that these two men are doing in preaching the gospel, in lecturing and teaching in colleges, and in raising young preachers, pastors and evangelists for the work in India. Now we thank you for all those done and for all those who were involved in here in Australia, here in our own church for the meetings of the Indian Reform Fellowship. We pray also this evening, tonight, for the Queensland Government. They intend to bring the euthanasia bill into the Parliament with an increased majority. It is highly unlikely that that will be stopped. But Lord, we pray for the day when governments like this will no longer bring curses upon us and bring judgment upon us. We pray, our God, for the restraint of evil in these kinds of governments, that they might instead be moved to do things that promote life and health and strength, that they might be wise and guided by good principles instead of by evil and selfish principles. Please give the wisdom to the Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk. By common grace, may she rule with wisdom and avoid folly, and that you'd give special wisdom to the treasurer of the state, as the state has racked up an enormous debt which will continue to blow out under the policies of the government, if the past is any guide. We commend the opposition to you, the new leader and his deputy. We do pray, our God, for mercy for them. They might provide true leadership and true unity, which has been so lacking in a party over nearly a whole generation, racked by disunity and selfishness and empire building and egos. Oh Lord, may the Liberal National Party be a true party in opposition and a strong alternative to the current government. May they also be a party where the principles and ethics of the historical conservative politics, influenced as it often is by the Judeo-Christian ethic, may this be strong once again in this party. We pray, our God, also for Phil Strong, the state moderator, that you take, give him mercies in travel and wisdom in speaking, and that you'd be pleased to help the church, help him guide the church with other office bearers through these difficult times, especially in the wake of the financial troubles, serious troubles that our church has fallen into. We thank you, our God, also for the work amongst the young. We pray for school chaplains in Queensland, for the spirit to stir men and women to to be raised to serve you in the schools, young men and women, to be chaplains to the primary and secondary students who need the influence and the example of mature Christians in their midst. Stir the hearts of local churches and office bearers and other mature Christians to come to get alongside of these young men and women to help them in their difficulties. And we think especially as we close of Jasmine Pierce, our sister who is preparing for the schoolies mission. We thank you for the burden in her heart that she has to speak the good news of Jesus Christ to others of her own age group. We thank you for others who are with her. Similarly, Lord, may this zeal, this youthful zeal, may it only begin to burn in the lives of these young people and especially in the life of our sister as she learns how to deal with conversations about the things of God with people. May she learn quickly and skillfully, and may she be guided through prayer and the Spirit into many opportunities in which people can hear the truth, so that you will take that truth and bring living faith to them as a result. As we come to the Word of God tonight, our Father, would you pray that you'd help us to grow through what we hear. May the Word delivered be delivered with power and effect into our lives. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're back into the Gospels this evening. Probably should be Mark's version of this. That will probably be the title when it goes up online. But it's coming from Matthew 14, Matthew's account of this event. Next week we will be in the second part of this, which deals with Peter walking on the water as well as our Lord. So the title, as you can see in the bulletin sheet, is Journeying from Fear to Faith. Journeying from Fear to Faith. Now, the event in the Gospels that is often referred to as Jesus walking on the water is one of the most famous of his miracles. Skeptics often cite it as proof of the unbelievability of the Bible. But ironically, it is in fact one of the most convincing evidences of the claims of Jesus Christ and the New Testament writers. It represents a moment in time when the disciples either passed from belief into faith, or that process of passing from belief into faith was strengthened. I say that because there is a difference between belief and faith. Belief is a conviction or a certainty about something, but it is with or without evidence. Belief is possible, and in fact it is common in spite of the evidence. Children often believe things without any evidence, and sometimes in spite of the evidence. The Santa myth, of course, quickly comes to mind. It can be hard to get them to accept the truth. Well, we know that some adults too can persist in believing things, sometimes for a while and sometimes forever, in spite of the hard evidence. If you don't believe me, talk to somebody who believes in the flat earth. But this kind of approach, this belief, is not the biblical faith. Biblical faith is conviction based upon evidence. The whole basis on which the prophet's testimony was to be believed in the Old Testament was their power, or at least God's power through the miracles, signs and wonders as they are called, as Jeremiah did. Our Lord said it himself this way in John 10:36-38. You are blaspheming because I said I am the Son of God. If I do not do the works of my Father, then do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe the Father is in me and I am in him. Again, John himself said this in John 20:31. And truly Jesus did many other signs, miraculous signs, in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you might have life in his name. Evidence-based faith is what God has given us. He has given us four witnesses in the gospel to the signs and wonders of the Saviour, the prophet of all prophets. And John says that these are our basis for trusting that he is who he said he is. In fact, our very eternal security, our assurance of personal salvation, depends upon this very trust in the record of Christ's life and ministry, as John reminded us in John 20:31 that I read. So biblical faith is not a mere matter of intellectual curiosity or religious allegiance, although it is for some. Your very eternal life hangs upon that faith, that trust, and its object, Jesus Christ. So tonight I want to look at this famous example of the evidence that Jesus is God incarnate, the eternal Son of God, in his walk upon the storm-tossed sea of Galilee in the dead of the night. This event, like every such miraculous event, is stunning and powerful in its emotional impact, even just to read it. Out of this event, I want to consider the power of Christ, the perception of Christ, and then the word of Christ as these things manifested themselves in the event. So firstly tonight, from this passage, the power of Christ as revealed in Scripture. Now this dramatic moment of the fresh is a fresh revelation of the power and the nature of Christ, and it came in ominous circumstances. The disciples, some of whom were experienced fishermen, were straining at the oars in the Sea of Galilee, as verse 47 and 48 tell us. Now when evening came, the boat was in the middle of the sea, and he was alone on the land. Then he saw them straining at rowing, for the wind was against them. Now it was about the fourth watch of the night. He came to them, walking on the sea, and he would have passed them by. I want you to note a couple of things about this incident. It involves two miracles, actually three, but tonight we'll consider two. Two evidences of the divine authority of God for Jesus the prophet, and two evidences of the of the divine nature of Christ. And these were simply walking on the water and then the calming of the sea. A further one, of course, is Peter's walk himself upon the water, which we shall consider next time. It'll be next week. Let's think about them for a moment as we come to this moment, somewhere between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. in the morning, while it was still the dead of the night. And he appears out of the gloom, striding across the storm-tossed sea toward them. The first thing we note is that he defied for some time, and probably for an hour or more, the law of gravity in walking upon the surface of the waters of the sea. If you will excuse the pun, let that sink in. It was an hour or more that he walked on the liquid surface. More than that, as we've heard, it was not a mill pond. It was stirred up by a very great wind. These waves terrified experienced fishermen in Peter. And yet our Lord walked calmly, it seems, from the shore out into the dark of the night toward this fishing boat that was powered by oars. Now, of course, marine miracles, we could call them that, are found in the Old Testament. We know Moses, Elijah, and Elisha did water or marine miracles. None, however, involved this kind of feat. However, one we heard tonight involved a similar violation of the law of gravity, namely the floating axe head. This is a reminder of the repeated statement of the Lord that nothing is impossible or nothing is too hard for him. And so this also was not too hard for our Saviour. The second miracle of the creation was the stilling of the wind. And this is one of two instances of our Lord having this impact upon the environment. The other is Matthew 8:23-27, and there the response to his ability to control the atmosphere, at a word, was, "Who can this be that even the winds and the seas obey him?" So now we see his power to affect the atmosphere, at least locally. And of course, we know globally if he had to. The disciples' response is expected and proper. They just did not realize who it was they were dealing with. They did not realize the power and the control that he possessed at that point. But then they did not understand the fullness of his identity and person at that point. But Joseph Benson sums up this Christ who walked upon the stormy sea for several hours as follows. What a wonderful proof we have here of Christ's sovereign power over creatures, which are all under his feet and at his command, forgetting their natures and changing their most essential qualities at his word. Well, brethren, this is your Christ. This is your Saviour. The world at large, which generally accepts his historical existence now, and which even acknowledges that the records of his word as contained in the New Testament are true generally, still only sees him as an admirable man and a very positive and largely influential person in history. They have the rest of the record, but they cannot accept the fullness of it as you and I can. And this is because in the end it is too much for them. And understandably so, because ultimately it takes grace, divine grace, to be able to personally confess him as he really is, the risen Son of the living God. Remember what Jesus said to Peter when Peter professed this very thing in Matthew 16:17. Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." So others, in their ignorance and unbelief, and you must be patient and understanding of those faults in other people, others in their ignorance and unbelief may ascribe this story to legend, but you know that it is history. And that, by the way, is why I never speak of the events of the Old or the New Testament as stories. Stories are associated with tales, legends, and myths. They are associated with literature, literary and oral records that are, as children say, made up. So though it is a small point, and I think Ken Ham of Answers in Genesis made the point first, the events of the Old and the New Testament are not these kinds of stories. They are history. They are eyewitness accounts of real people, by real people, of real events. And they should always be called that when we speak about them. They are God-breathed history, and they are not cleverly devised tales of men, as Peter asserts in 2 Peter 1:16. My Saviour and yours walked on water. He calmed the wind and the sea here without a single word, but in Matthew 8:27 with a rebuke. A currently popular English pastor, whose name escapes me, it's probably good, but who doesn't believe Genesis 1-11 is history and probably rejects much of the rest of the miraculous in Scripture, said this: we must not take the Bible literally, but we must take it seriously. And my reply to that is, if you don't take the historical narrative literally, you are not taking it seriously. You are making liars out of the authors. You're making liars out of the Holy Spirit. You're making a liar out of Jesus himself. The man we worship as God is the man Christ Jesus. That we should worship him is clear from Matthew 14:33 in this very passage. After the disciples saw Peter walk on water toward him, and then the stormy seas were calm, they worshipped him, quote unquote. Verse 33. This is the real Jesus. This is the true Christ, who is truly God and truly man, and who is truly and properly to be worshipped. We are, yes, to pay homage to him, to homage to him alone in families and in corporate worship. He is now the risen King of kings and Lord of all lords, and every knee will one day bow before him and declare him to be Lord, Yahweh of the Old Testament, to the glory of God the Father. Well, that is the evidence or part of it that takes us from fear to faith with this one whom we know as Jesus the Christ. Knowing who he is And what he can do lays the foundation for our trust. It helps us to bond to him through the Holy Spirit, and to bond to such a degree that we will eventually entrust our lives and every part of our lives and even death to him in obedience. How does that help us on the road from fear to faith in him? Let's talk now about the change in the perception of Christ from being with faith and without faith. The disciples at this point had not reached this deeper knowledge of him. As we come to the moment of crisis in this account, we realize this. The evangelist records the terrifying moment as follows in 49 and 50 of the 14th chapter of Matthew. When they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed it was a ghost, and they cried out. We could perhaps say they screamed out, for they all saw him and they were terrified or troubled. Well, the word troubled here is an understatement, because if you cry out as terrified, if you cry out because you're terrified, it's because you are terrified. A cry like that is forced out of you. For example, if you think that you're about to fall off a high point and plunge to great harm or to death. It's the cry of animals when they are about to be mauled by a predator. The cry is ejected instinctively because terror forces it out of us. This was the situation that they faced. And it is a real truth, of course, that humans so often fear what they don't understand. That's actually a line from a movie, but it is very true. Humans so often fear what they don't understand. We fear technology sometimes. We fear new circumstances sometimes. We fear changed circumstances. Some suffer fear worse than others, but fear is a natural built-in emotion for helping us to deal and to prepare for danger, whether real or potential. And the presence of spiritual evil can certainly justify the cause for terror. In this case, they had cause because they believed that it could only be a wicked spirit on the surface of the waters. The Greek word here is the word phantasma, which is translated sometimes phantom or ghost or apparition. It seems to describe something, in this case, ghostly or see-through. Even though these beings or creatures, and I'm speaking of the spirits, can appear in many ways to people, everything from appearing as solid human beings to see-through apparitions of human form, or even formless, to animal-like in their form. In this case, the disciples mistook the Lord for a human spirit, or what we would call today commonly a ghost. And just by the way, all ghost sightings that are genuine are fallen or evil angels or angelic spirits. They are not human spirits of the deceased. Now, in my more than 30 years of ministry, I have encountered at least six people or six households who have had personal encounters with spirits of the kind that the disciples thought the Lord was. In three of these instances, the apparition was visually terrifying. One of them was initially mistaken for a human being until it disappeared through a closed door in a hotel in England. This last apparition was seen by a woman who at the time did not believe in ghosts, and while she could see it, at the very same time her husband could not. They do not always appear in frightening forms. When they appear in the forms, why they appear in the forms that they do often has to do with their purpose, and they do have different purposes. But that's another matter. What you need to know and to accept is that these creatures are real, that they do manifest themselves to people, and that they can frighten or terrify people when they do. And just by the way, I have met non-Christian people who are aware of these things and accept their existence, and they simply call them entities. Entities. In the case of the disciples here, their response is perfectly natural. It is that of terror. But as we know, this reaction to spirits, unclean or evil or demonic, whatever you wish to call them, of course, would eventually change. Later, these same frightened disciples would learn not only not to be frightened of demons, they would learn to command them with authority and scatter them from their host victims. If I might add here, know that Christ will give you and to me the same ability to face evil and unexpected evil. He will enable us to recognize it and to cope with it as we encounter it, if we should. Some of you may have heard of the Lutheran evangelist Kurt Koch, whose books are still available online. They provide very helpful information in dealing with the occult firsthand, especially in recognizing the demonic, the spirit in its different forms, and differentiating between the effects of demonic activity from human illness, especially mental illness, and dealing with the phenomena. I personally have no desire ever to confront such creatures and their power. But I do know that as with all God's enemies, the help of God against them is accessed by prayer. And prayer is the most important resource you will ever have in dealing with them, should you have to deal with them. Koch makes this point several times and gives several examples of this as a remedy for the very serious manifestations of the demonic that took place in the first few decades post-World War II in Europe, where he served as an evangelist and had a special ministry in this. The disciples just cried out, understandably in shock, but that cry ultimately would be learned to be directed to God, a far greater spirit who was ever present, who can be instantly mobilized against these spirits, as Jesus promised in Mark 9:29. So what is the lesson here about, again, these circumstances in which we are troubled? Joseph Benson is going to answer that question in terms of application. Thus, God often lengthens the troubles of his people and defers the time of their deliverance. But when things have come to an extremity and they are ready to think that he has forgotten them, he unexpectedly appears for their relief and rescue. Of a sudden, the storm becomes a calm, and they are happily brought into a safe port. Thus, in the morning watch, he appeared for Israel in the Red Sea, troubled and dismayed by their pursuing enemies. And there he delivered his people. And in all ages, the extremity of his church has been his opportunity to visit and to appear for her. He that keeps Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps has constantly his eye upon them. And when there is need, he walks in darkness for their comfort, support, and succor. Well, let's turn from the moment of fear to the pathway of faith, or trust, if you like, as our final point tonight, and it has to do with the power of the Word of Christ and its effect. The journey from fear to faith begins with knowing Christ and learning to recognize and trust the voice of Christ. It is, of course, preceded by knowing about him. Even though these men did not realize that he could walk on water at night and on a stormy sea, nonetheless, when they heard his voice, they calmed down immediately. The trust they had was already based on past experience or evidence. They already had in him, and this was the key. To put this another way, if the same thing would happen again, knowing that he could walk upon water, they would not so hastily jump to the same conclusion. The same course would not be true of other crises. They would learn to trust him so that when he left this earth, they could face danger and not be paralyzed in their life and work. So Matthew records the following, "But immediately he talked with them and said to them, 'Be of good cheer. It is I, do not be afraid.' Then he went up into the boat to them and the wind ceased, and they were astonished." Our ability to trust God in Christ begins with a knowledge of the person himself. We learn that in the calm of life from parents, church, and eventually our own study of the revelation of God in Christ. We get to know about him. the way that a pen friend gets to know about another pen friend who lives far away. The scripture gives us a true and accurate knowledge of God, which is intellectual and consists of valuable, precious information about God in Christ. I say God in Christ because it is not merely the man Jesus of Nazareth that we are getting to know. The constant reference to Jesus in modern services and ministry is dangerously lopsided in its preoccupation with his manhood, which is born of not wanting to offend the non-religious. I said early on, most people have positive views about Jesus of Nazareth, but the true knowledge of God is not solely about Christ the man, and not primarily about Christ the man. He came as a man to reveal God in his fullness to us, to lay open a relationship for us with God the Father. But we also know the Father and the Son through the Spirit. So it is truly God in Christ we come to know, with whom we should be acquainting ourselves, even if Jesus Christ is central to that process and goal of knowing God in his fullness. Beyond the intellectual knowledge, through study, there is of course another knowledge. That is the intimate personal knowledge of God through the Holy Spirit, to which John refers in his Gospel and letter. The Greek word used is the one meaning full or complete knowledge, and it reflects the Hebrew word to know, which means intimate knowledge. Disciples were growing to that point. This experience, like all the others, would bring them to that full and complete and mature knowledge upon which they could rest their lives, especially in danger in the future. To all the remarkable things that they had already learned about their master and what he was capable of, now this ability to move across stormy waters was added. You know, it is one thing for us to say, I know that nothing is impossible for God in Christ. But it is another thing to face a threat and say confidently that we know he has our back and that we are safe in him. But it is true, isn't it? The older we get, the more assured we should be that he will provide, that he will protect, that he will pity, no matter what comes. However, our experience of his grace to us in our daily lives teaches us that his grace is sufficient for us when we are struggling to serve, as Paul in 2 Corinthians 12:9. It teaches our experience of his faithfulness in provision eventually teaches us to trust if we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, he will add all those things to us, that he is our helper and he will provide. The personal knowledge with the personal experience of God's faithfulness, especially in danger, it brings us this faith that is based upon evidence. We learn to trust because of what he's revealed about himself in Scripture, and because of what he does for us and others around us in our experience of his kind and faithful providential care. When he called back to them, "It is I, do not be afraid," at that moment fear was replaced by faith and terror by trust. Once they knew it was him, then they knew that it was okay. And it is true of all of his people, all of the time. It is always him. He is always here. He is always near. He has promised never to forsake. He will never leave his people. And we will never see him this side of heaven with our eyes of flesh, but with the eyes of faith, with the perception of biblical revelation, we will recognize him in the very things that are happening around us as we pass through them. We will know it is him. We will remember that even when the worst comes, he is in the midst of it with us, working it for our good. So here is the difference. Once faith replaces fear, this time from John Gill. Christ may be sometimes near to his people, yet they may not know him. As the Lord was in the place where Jacob was, but he knew it not, in Genesis 28:16. And as Christ was standing right by Mary Magdalene at the sepulchre, and she took him to be the gardener, but when Christ makes himself known unto them as the able and willing Saviour, as their saving Redeemer, then instead of dreading him as judge, Their fears vanish, and their faith increases, and they are ready to do anything he shall order them, as Peter says in the next verse. He was willing to come to Christ on the water when he knew who it was, if he was but pleased to ask him to come. If you live knowing him and welcoming him into your life, dear friend, be assured when you die, you can die confidently knowing that he will welcome you into his fellowship in his Father's house. So that was the journey from fear to faith. The knowledge about Christ had to be supplemented with the knowledge of Christ through personal experience. Had they known then what they would learn later, they would not immediately have concluded that a malicious spirit was approaching them on the waters. How different is that experience to the promise of Christ to his disciples in John 14:1-3? That when they died, he would come again to receive them to himself. Or the account of the soul of Lazarus taken from this miserable life of suffering, taken in the care of angels beyond death. So I could ask you tonight, what kind of spirit will you see when you die? Will it be an angelic spirit that will inspire the warm sense of divine welcome? Or will it be an evil spirit that inspires a sense of terror, as Cox says he saw some experience as they died? If Christ has cleared the debt for your sins, if you are now living to imitate and to serve and to worship him, then you can be assured that you will meet that welcoming spirit or spirits, and possibly even Christ himself. You will certainly approach Christ in heaven on his throne without any fear, even boldness, because he has forgiven all those sins, your sins, for which he long ago died. He will have known you from the day of that first confession of your sin and faith in him until the day when you come to him through the door of death and the throne of grace into life everlasting. And that is something about him which is worth treasuring. Let's all pray. Our Father in heaven, as we are reminded tonight of how life can present us with things that are completely unexpected, it is good to know that none of this is unexpected to you, that in the midst of our troubles that you are always near, that in the midst of others' troubles you are similarly near. And so we pray that as you have reminded us of these things tonight, of your nearness and of your capacities to save and to deliver us from all our troubles, may we go into this week every day prayerfully with that confidence, being encouraged and also being an encouragement to others to seek you and to know you. And we ask this in the Lord Jesus' name. Amen. So let's sing to God's praise a declaration of our trust in God. All my hope on God is founded, all my trust he shall renew.
Thank you.
benediction, and then we shall sing together the threefold Amen to conclude our service tonight. Now the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.